So this was our class for last week, Saadia Gaon, and because there's so much to talk about, we decided to split Saadia Gaon in two. I mean, not the person, of course, but the class. And so this is Saadia Gaon part two. Let me briefly go through, recap a little bit what we talked about, so we're all on one line, one level. This part two. We spoke about Saadia Gaon, where he came from. He was really a progeny, right? He was extremely brilliant because when he was 20 years old, he already wrote dictionaries. Like a dictionary, it wasn't just copying an existing dictionary, it's actually going through the language and gathering all the words and then making a dictionary to one, the normal one, where you look things up after the first letter, but also one where you look things up after the last letter. That was in an age before personal computers. You just have to do it all handwritten with a quill and with ink. When you're 20 years old and you succeed in from scratch writing a dictionary and thinking out, you know, if I do it at the last letter, it'll be a tool for poets, and it's going to be used, that's going to work wonderfully. And you actually, I mean, this is really amazing. He must have worked so hard at it. And and we also know that as a young child, a rather young person, he wrote some poetry. So we went through we don't have much of his poetry, at least I have not been able to find much of it, but I found some, and we went through two strophes, which were actually, if you haven't seen it, if you weren't there, go through the previous video, and then you see the explanation. But this was a poem in a context of anti-Karaite polemics. Nonetheless, it was very innovative stuff. Now, we also saw that we spoke about the Babylonian and the Palestinian forms of Judaism at the time, and how in Babylonia there was a leader of the Jews, basically a king in exile, so to say, because he was descendant of King David, and was called the Exilarch in Greek, I think, yeah? Exile arch, right? So the head of the Jews in exile. He was the secular leader of the Jews, and then you had the spiritual leaders who were called Gaonim. One of the Gaonim is called Gaon, that is singular. Gaonim is plural, and there were Gaonim in Palestine and in Babylon. The Babylonians gradually became more influential, and they competed with each other. We see that Saadia Gaon, also still quite young, wrote in defense of the Babylonian Gaonim, who were the most influential. And he was actually then, surprisingly, the first time in history as a non-Babylonian, because he came from Egypt, appointed as one of the Gaonim in Babylonia. And we also saw that he started in no time fighting with the Exilarch overall. And there were a lot of writings back and forth. Some of it we have. It's not all, as you say in Judaism, lishma. It wasn't all for the sake of holy topics. There were allegations back and forth. Actually, Saadia Gaon was also one of the things that never gets any attention, and I'm sure never heard. But he was also accused of sexual misconduct. I don't want to go into that too deeply. That's like would be a topic of itself. Let's stick to the religious topics and parts of his life. But even people who do amazing things are not always perfect. You know, it's not so that you're a great scholar and then you are righteous in every other aspect of life. So we have to, it's always good to know that a person is vulnerable to doing bad things at the same time as good things. Okay, go to the next. It was probably not all just made up, is what I'm trying to say. And then we saw that they eventually made up, the Exilarch and Saadia Gaon, but a few years before they died. So unfortunately, a big chunk of their life was wasted in fighting, although not wasted because Saadia Gaon spent his these years writing a lot of interesting stuff. So one of the most important things that he wrote, and we've been talking about that, is this is a slide from last time, the Book of Beliefs and Opinions. I actually had a copy of this, but I just put it away in my on my bookshelf. But the Book of Beliefs and Opinions, it was written in Arabic, Kitab al-Amanat wal-I'tiqadat, but in Hebrew, most people have studied it in Hebrew, was translated into Hebrew later in the, a little bit later, a few centuries later, there was a whole movement of scholars who started, and linguists who started translating these Hebrew writings from the time that most Jews spoke Hebrew. In those time, the majority of the Jews lived under Islam and therefore spoke Hebrew, Arabic, sorry, they spoke Arabic. And the people who outside the Arabic world were marginal, weren't really looked at, was not really in the on the horizon of most people. So most people speak Arabic, so people wrote in Arabic, a language that people understood much better than Hebrew. But then when that changed, there was a whole movement of translating these books into Hebrew. And the Book of Beliefs and Opinions was one of the first and important books to be translated. And so it was known and studied by most people in the Hebrew, eventually under the name Sefer, the Book of Emunot Vedeot, Beliefs and Opinions. It's literally a literal translation. And therefore, yeah, well, we are actually, the course is about Hebrew, masterpieces of Hebrew literature. Okay, it's a bit limited because so many, there's a number of things that are so influential that are written in Arabic. So it's not technically a Hebrew masterpiece. On the other hand, in my defense, I reasoned that as it was translated to Hebrew and studied mostly in Hebrew, we can still call it a Hebrew masterpiece in a way. Okay. And then we spoke also, what's very important for our topic, about a philosophy called Kalam. And one, there's different types of Kalam, but this type of Kalam was basically started, had been started by, well, mostly Muslims, because they were the dominating group, of course, after Islam had conquered the Middle East. And it's an Arabic word, but it really came to be because people had discovered the old Greek philosophers and had started translating it into Arabic. And so in Arabic, these philosophers, Plato, Aristotle, and others were studied. And then people came to the conclusion or to the insight that actually science or scientific thinking or reasoning, right? Thinking deeply, drawing conclusions based on thoughts. And that was, you can come to certain insights, to certain truths. And this is important because the idea, the insight became, the thought became that for Muslims, for Jews, for Christians, they have holy books, and the holy books are believed to be sources of knowledge and sources of insight about how the world works. And often these books have been taken in a literal sense. Let's say if God creates the world in 7 days, people said there has to be in 7 days. It says it there, right? And other things too. So if you take it in a literal sense, but now you're starting to think of reason. So if the revelation is true, and if reason is a God-given tool to find truth also, then the two, revelation and reason, you see them on top here, have to coincide with each other. Cannot, absolutely impossible that they will, conflict with each other. Now, what to do, and somebody, one of you wrote me a question after class, what do you do as a religious person when you don't seem to be able to harmonize the two, when you don't seem to be able to take them in sync with each other? If they seem to conflict, what do you choose? I did not answer that because we're going to get into that later, and that's a whole topic, like an important part of a class, classes on Maimonides, because he actually gives a clear answer to that. Very interesting answer. But I don't know, if you're really torturous and you don't want to be kept in suspense, I could answer the question, but I thought it would be a good cliffhanger to wait for that. So basically, reason and revelation are on the same par as science and scripture. That's the same thing, right? Science, or look, philosophy, science, medicine, all these things were the same thing in the Middle Ages. A scientist was also a philosopher. It's like clear thinking, having and learning to deduct one thing from another, and astronomy. Everything was seen as a mathematician. Mathematics were all seen as aspects of the same thing, basically understanding the universe. Right. So when you study a body, as a student physician studying medicine, or you're studying math, or you're studying even linguistics sometimes, you're studying astronomy, then you're just basically observing and studying and making sense of how the world works. And there's a unity in the universe. So in my body, certain forces are at work. Those are the same forces, thoughts, the philosophers, that are at work in the stars and in the galaxies. And actually that is still there's a macro and a microcosm. These are like gravity, certain pulling, magnetic fields, etc., the way atoms work and molecules is the same in our body as it is on the moon and on Jupiter and on a star. So it's sometimes really, really interesting how pre-science, just by thinking, people came to certain conclusions. Well, Saadia Gaon lives in a world, and the world is this new innovative thing that we have a religion, we honor and we respect, and we our scriptures. Once again, for Jews, that would be the Torah and other scriptures of the Hebrew Bible, prophetical books and other books, wisdom books, for instance, Psalms, which is poetry. And we take that, and for Muslims that is the Quran, and for Christians that would be mostly the New Testament. We believe that, we honor that, but then we're also trying to reach and figure out truth at the same time, and then to that one will affect the other, and how it affects the other is all very, very interesting. Talking too long again, but. Okay, now this is our last slide that has to do with last time. I changed this title in the dark a bit. It said, I think, about free will, but it has to do with God's justice and free will, and also the ability to act upon your free will. Three different things that are connected. We spoke about this at length. I'm not going to go into it much more. You should really watch that video if you haven't, and if you weren't at the class to catch up with that. But just in a few sentences, if God is just, and if there are consequences to our actions, we call this reward and punishment, then God would not be just if he would punish or reward people if they don't have free will. So if you have free will, then you're responsible for your actions. If you have free will, or at least you are able to make your own decisions and act upon these decisions, then you do something good or bad. It makes sense that there's reward and punishment. But if not, if God would just punish people or reward people for things that they're not responsible for, God would not be just. But it was still a big those days to say that people are fully responsible for their actions. That would mean that God is not really in charge of our actions. That means, and then the question comes up, is God really omnipotent? So meaning, is he all powerful? And so those are hot debates of the time. But I'm not gonna redo that discussion. So we're gonna go to the next slide, a new slide. Now we're gonna look at, what does Saadia Gaon say on creation? I just have a few topics, a bunch of topics from the Book of Opinions. I'm going to see, I think it's really interesting to see how he reasons, because the way he reasons gives us a peek into how people thought in those days. And this is, just remember, like 1100 years ago, this is a different world. And sometimes it's surprising how close he is to the way we think, and we think are very evolved by, but sometimes it's really, I think sometimes, of course, he uses ideas that we know not to be true. That, I mean, scientifically, he believes, he still thinks that the earth is flat, for instance. Now, even today, there are seem to be some people who believe the earth is flat, but I cannot even wrap my head around that. But of course, so there are different things are different. And sometimes it's really very remarkable and just surprising and almost, yeah, amusing, but just not in a negative way, how he thinks. That's an original idea. I'm not going to talk more. Let me go to this. So this is from Treatise 1 on creation, and I rephrased it. Sometimes I did that, sometimes not. Now let me ask somebody who hasn't, Makaya, you didn't read last class, I believe. So do you want to read a bit?
Sure.
Thank you.
Treatise 1 on creation, rephrased. How all things came into existence is something that no one has actually witnessed.
Yeah, so that's, so, sorry, you know how I interrupt everybody. But this is fair to say, right? So nobody has actually witnessed creation or the beginning of the universe. So what he means is, it's all, we can figure it out through reasoning, but we cannot really check it and repeat the experiment, of course. So that's fair to say. So, yeah?
So if we should reach the conclusion through reasoning that all things were created out of nothing, we should not reject it, only on the basis that we cannot see it.
Yeah, nobody, normally nothing comes out of nothing. That is just not what we know that it happens. But so he's basically saying, but if we have, and he wants to say that it's created out of nothing, because that is Jewish, Christian, Islamic point of view. God created the universe out of nothing. But he's basically already saying, if we reason, and then this will be our conclusion, don't cop out by saying, yeah, but I never see this in reality. That's, he says, fair enough, because it's all based on reasoning anyway, and not just on witnessing. Uh-huh.
Every theory is necessarily put forward, knowing that no one can observe it for himself.
Yeah, very good. Mm-hmm.
Materialists who believe in the eternity of the world too must try to prove that something, for example, matter, can exist without a beginning or an end, even though they have never actually experienced such a thing.
So there was a group of philosophers who believe materialists. Now I put Madonna there, material girl in a material world. That's not what materialism meant in those days. Materialism means that you believe that matter is eternal. So as if nothing can come out of nothing, then a horse came out of a mother horse, she came out of her mother horse. So if you go back, every horse comes out of another horse there, then if you go back indefinitely, then they're always must have been horses or pre-horses, you know what I'm saying? So something or something that looked like a horse or further and further, but some matter, some material has to always have been there. All matter is eternal according to materialists. Follow that? That makes sense? Yeah. The only thing is he says, but these people too has to now try to reason and prove through reasoning that that matter has to exist without a beginning. So it is also hard to believe that infinity, that there's infinite without a beginning. We cannot wrap around around anything that is eternal back to the beginning infinitely. Also, that is also very hard to wrap around. So they also cannot have a proof and show it. Uh-huh. Then you have a group called dualists.
Likewise, dualists must try to prove the existence of two mutually exclusive forces through which the world came into being, even though they have never seen such mutually exclusive elements, or how they could unite and become commingled to produce the universe.
Now, these are pictures, the picture, you saw a similar picture before, that with Jews under Islam. Those are Zoroastrians. And Zoroastrians are dualists. So they believe in two, almost equally, I'm not sure, but yeah, two opposite gods. You have a god of light and god of darkness, god of good and god of bad. And the two are balanced each other, and but they have nothing to do with each other. And they basically fight each other. It's the task of a believer, Zoroastrian believer, to side with the good god, the god of light, and to fight the darkness, so that can also inspire people to really do good things, right? Now, on the left is an old Zoroastrian idea. So on the left, in that picture, you see the good god, and on the right is the bad god. They have names also, but we'll look at that. But definitely, Zoroastrians was still a considerable group in Baghdad, where Saadia lived, and Baghdad had been part of the Persian Empire. So there's the old Persian religion still was around for sure. And it's now a rather small group, a very small group now, but in those days bigger for sure than now. So he knew, it's likely that Saadia Gaon knew Zoroastrian dualists, but not only Zoroastrians, there were also Greek thinkers who were dualists. Maybe you've heard of Gnosticism. Gnosticism is also a dualist system. Some of it, its influence have entered, I believe, a certain strains of Christianity. So many dualists will say, like you have heaven and earth, like you have good and bad, likewise you have spirituality and physicality. So the soul, the spirit, is part of the good world, and the physicality is part of the earth, which is now bad. In many dualistic systems, physicality is inherently bad and spirituality is inherently good. Judaism doesn't believe that. We believe that you can have good and bad spirituality and you can have good and bad physicality. The body is not necessarily bad, but dualists often think that. And you see that some influence in Catholicism, where a priest is supposed to be more spiritual than the average person, and therefore he has to be celibate, and actually to deny his physicality. This is somewhat related to a dualist worldview, but enough about that already. Okay, yeah?
We know already that God, exalted be he, revealed to us in the Torah that all things were created and that he created them out of nothing. Now we
So he says, this is revelation, right? From that we know, We believe that God created it out of nothing. It says in the below, in the beginning, God created heaven and earth. He brings it up. And the picture shows, Saadia Gaon seems to, it's clear from what he writes, still believe in an earth, which is flat, which is either floating on air or on water or anything else, right?
Now we want to see if this can be supported by reason as well. And I believe we can, based on four arguments. We will now see how 1,100 years ago, Saadia reasons about the origin of the universe in an age before modern science.
Yeah, so I think that should be interesting. Point one, we'll do one more page, Micaiah.
The earth and all the heavenly bodies are finite. We know that the earth is finite because if it was infinite, the sun and the moon could never revolve around it. And we can clearly see that the heavenly bodies are not infinite in size.
So nobody knew how big the earth was. That was later, right? When people thought, maybe we can travel around the world. So he thought, what if it's flat and what if it never stops? But he says it cannot, because then the sun cannot and the moon cannot revolve around it. In those days, they believed the sun revolves around the earth, which is not true. But the moon does, of course. So the same thing, if the moon revolves around the earth, then it cannot be infinite because it could never go around it. Actually, that was a Greek philosopher, and I forgot his name, who believed that the that the earth would just go a straight line, but every morning, and would never turn around. Every morning was a new sun, he believed. That would be a way to resolve that. But yeah, okay.
Now, since all that exists is limited, the forces in them must be limited as well. At some point, they'll run out, after which they cease to exist. In conclusion, anything that is limited in space is also limited in time. Therefore, the universe must have a beginning and an end.
Yeah, that's his way of reasoning. So if it's limited in space, it also has to limit it in time, because there's forces that sustain something that exists. And yeah, the sun has fuel, and it's a lot of fuel, and it burns. But the calculation is, I think after 5 million years, it should burn out. And so we better buy good sweaters before that time. But so it's that we will not live to see that, but there is a limitation, and therefore it's not, it's limited in time. This is his idea, that his proof, it's a creative way of thinking, that all the heavenly bodies are also not infinite, and therefore must have a beginning and an end. So in modern terms, let's go to Natalie.
In modern terms, scientists reason and calculate that before the Big Bang, there was no space and time. The Big Bang then, out of nowhere, seems to have created a so-called space-time sheet to enable the existence of matter. In other words, even though our senses and even our reason dictates that nothing can come out of nothing, the universe seems to have a beginning.
Yeah. Now, of course, scientists will never, and that's good for them, because we'll never accept a mystery. So we don't know. Out of nowhere did the Big Bang come. Now, what was really, just like it's the smallest pinprick in the universe in time and space would produce the universe, but you want to still know how did that happen. So that's a big speculation. We have no clue. Scientifically, some people think that maybe the universe breathes in and out. So the Big Bang is breathing out the universe, and then maybe it stops, and then it goes back in, and then into the smallest point, and then it breathes again, and everything repeats itself. That's another theory, but those are all theories. But still, there would be you could still say that our universe has a beginning, and also the fact that before the Big Bang there was no time. It's very hard for us to, we don't know of any situation without time. All we live in is time. So it's really hard to imagine timelessness, but science is very hard. I'm not really a scientist, but I find it fascinating to look at these things. We'll go to the second argument. Why does he think, what is his proof that the earth was created in time and it has a beginning? Mm-hmm.
Everything that exists in a composition of parts, connection, and divisions. This is a sign that they are the work of a maker. Plants consist of veins and stems, branches, leaves, and roots, etc.
Yeah, so they're put together, it seems. Doesn't sound so scientific, but we'll see.
Bodies are an intricate composition of body parts. Yes, even each part is composed of smaller parts and so on. The earth itself, too, is made up of soil and dust and stones and minerals and the like.
Yeah, and he didn't even know deeper than that. You have lava and magma and all that stuff. And just think of it, that we are just a floating blob of hot, of heat, of melted, and only the outer crust is cooled down by the universe, and we can actually live on that, on top of all. That's already, for me, like miraculous, but you shouldn't use the word miraculous as a scientific thinking person too soon, but it's definitely extreme. And you know what was funny when I posted this? Looks like the eye looks a bit like the earth, doesn't it? It's a macrocosm, microcosm. Yeah. Uh-huh.
According to modern scientists, in the first 10 to the negative 12 seconds of the existence of our universe, this space-time spewed roughly 10 to the 87 elementary particles called quarks. By some force, these quarks untied to form photons, protons, neutrons, and electrons. These again fell in love with each other and formed atoms. Atoms teamed up to form molecules, and after many stages of cooperation and joining, these formed galaxies, stars, seas, lizards, lobsters, puppies, bees, humans, societies, brains, intelligence. Not to talk about a personal human-like physical god on a throne in the sky, those are just images. There seems to be a creative, intelligent, constructive force in the universe that encourages the creation of ever more intricate forms of existence.
Yeah, what do I say? Well, first of all, not believing in God, so the question is always, what do you call God and how do you define God? If you define God as a physical man with a beard on the throne, then I probably agree with you. I think that's an image. So maybe I shouldn't have written, these are just images, because that's my opinion. If somebody wants to believe in that in a literal way, then I should not maybe discourage him or put them down by saying these are just images. I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings or anything, so hopefully I didn't do that. But I think it seems to me fair to say, but who am I? Okay, but there seems to be a power, a force in the universe that enables or generates these constructions of little particles that joining together. Now, that force, if you call that God, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's personal in the way we think of a person, because we think of a person as a human, usually, right? But it is definitely, it happens in an intelligent way, in a constructive way. So that's why I call it an intelligent force. It's not too crazy, I think, to say that. Okay, now his third. Now this is very classical. This is very hard to relate to in modern thoughts, but maybe Natalie, can you read this?
Everything has accidents.
So accidents, yeah. What are accidents? It's an accident. I'm not referring to that cup on the right that is broken. That was also an accident, but what does that mean?
In classic Platonic philosophy, an accident is a non-essential feature of something.
Okay, so you have all these cups, right? So look at the green cup. So you have an orange cup. You have a cup with all kinds of colors. You have a translucent cup. Why is that? This is called an accident because it's not an essential thing. It's exchangeable. You can have, if you have a cup with all these different colors, then color is not an essential part of the cup. Is that correct? You can change the color and still have a cup. Okay, so color is called an accident. It's accidentally there, right? By coincidence, whatever. It's not, doesn't change the essence of the cup. Then you have the material. You can have ceramic. Let's say here, I have a cup here, right? See, ceramic. You can have plastic. You can have hard plastic, glass, paper cups. You can have with an ear, with two ears, with no ear. You can have the size is an accident. You can even have a whole cup and a broken cup. So broken is also an accident in numerous ways of the word. A full cup and an empty cup. All these things are not essential. Now, but what now is the essential cup? If you take away all these features that are not essential, what do you end up with? You end up with something that is not a real cup. I mean, not a physical cup. Maybe a spiritual cup or something. It's what's called the idea of a cup, the essential cup. Maybe read this. This is a bit, in other words, what I just explained.
According to this thinking, if you remove all the accidents of an object, you end up with its essence, which is not anything concrete, merely the idea of the thing. Yet this idea is timeless, more essential, and therefore more real than the physical form.
So that is the world of ideas that's Platonic. So you have the, it's like the concepts, the ideas. It ties into the story of creation that God speaks and it's there. Now, when it's a thought, when you speak, you pronounce a thought, right? First you have a thought, and then you speak. When it's a thought, it's nothing concrete. It's only the idea. Then when you speak it, that is meaning you make it concrete, you bring it into the physical world. By the way, if you go back to physics, you go back to the electrons and the protons, and you cut, and then you break that up, and you have these quarks, and you break that up according to string theory. Everything is just energy vibration, and speech is also energy vibration. This is very interesting. I don't think that Genesis is trying to give a scientific report of the creation of the world, but it's still very remarkable that these things coincide.
So how do they explain what accidents are? If it's not essential, then how do they explain what it is or how God made it?
The accidents are part of creation, but the essence is uncreated, so pre-created in a way. Does that make sense at all, Sylvie?
Yeah.
So, nothing can be created without accidents, right? So this is the idea. Everything that has an accident is created and is not timeless. And that's his idea, that's his proof. So
everything was created first and then the accident was made?
Yeah, so maybe even you could say that the essence is almost, according to some philosophers, is almost a eternal principle, like an eternal idea, that in the mind of God, cups are always there and humans are always there. Yeah?
Okay.
That's what I think. That's how I understand this concept. It's always, look, yeah, I try to learn this stuff, yeah. And it's not so always so easy to explain because to find the information because one philosopher says it different from another, and I'm trying to bring it all together to just classical philosophy. But of course, every philosopher sees it a bit different, so it's sometimes very confusing to figure it out. But how I understand it, that's how it is. No, I'm not saying that's how it is, but this is how I understand the concept.
Yeah.
Okay, Natalie, finish this one, please.
Think of a platonic relationship in which nothing physical happens.
Oh, you've heard of a platonic relationship. Everybody knows that, right? Mm-hmm. So that's just the idea. I mean, are you in a relationship? Yeah, platonic. That means it's in your head. There's nothing physical. Yeah.
According to medieval philosophers, God cannot have any accidents. He is pure essence.
So that is the difference with God. God is eternal, and therefore he is only essence. No accidents, which causes a lot of problems in for believers, because the way we describe God is physical, is not physical necessarily, but is at least it fits our vocabulary and our ideas and our worldview, right? We can only relate to God in things that we can relate to, but God is, we cannot relate to a cup that is only essence. It's nothing we think of. We cannot, one of the essential things in my opinion from a cup is that you can drink from it, but you cannot drink from an essential cup. So, right? There's nothing, maybe your spirit can, I don't know, but that goes too far. But if God is only essence, how do we relate to him? So, but that's a different topic. Okay, Preen.
I found that all existing bodies have accidents and are therefore not eternal. These accidents are either caused by these bodies themselves or by external factors.
See, everything that exists has accidents, right? Mm-hmm.
For instance, animals grow and increase in size until they reach maturity. Then they diminish again and disintegrate.
Yeah, so I think he's almost saying that accidents are also under influence of change. So an animal grows, that he has a size, and now he becomes bigger and bigger and becomes smaller and smaller, stronger, weaker. Those are all fluctuating accidents.
The heavenly bodies, too, are not immune from accidents, as we can clearly observe. They move along different routes and at different speeds. Some shade light while others don't, and the light they spread also has different colors, whitish, reddish, yellowish, or greenish.
Yeah, very good. Okay, so his last, fourth and last argument is about time. This is amusing. I find it so funny and so innovative and so it's probably he didn't make it up himself. I'm sure these are arguments that are used by others too. But it's so surprising to think that way. But pay attention. I hope you enjoy it as much as I do. Preen.
Time can be divided into three parts, past, present, and future. Even though the present is shorter than any imaginable duration, let's imagine the present as a point in time. If someone in the present, even in his imagination, wants to travel all the way back to the ultimate beginning of eternity, it would not be possible as eternity is infinite, and one can never travel to the end of infinity.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because your trip back to time would be infinite, so you would never reach the end if it's infinite, right? Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Likewise, if the universe was eternal and had not been created in time, existence could never have traveled along the infinite timeline to the present. It could never have reached us, and we would not have come into being.
Now, this is the funny part, you know? It's so, wow, what a way of thinking. So, you have a timeline. I could never go to the beginning of existence. Now, existence is a line of cause and effect. So I am the effect of the love of my parents, right? And they are the effect of another cause. And so everything is a cause and effect. So if you have a timeline, you would have cause and effect if it's infinite from the very beginning. But the first cause, there is no first cause, basically, in that case. So if the beginning of existence was infinitely away, The path to, like for us, we're here, and the path to the beginning of existence would be unlimited, and therefore you could never traverse that distance. But the other way around too, the beginning of existence would be infinitely away. It could never come to us. So existence could never reach us, and we could never exist. That's a really, enjoyable way of thinking. I just get pleasure from that. I don't know. Yeah? And the last paragraph?
In other words, if the universe were eternal, it cannot exist. Since, however, I find that I do exist, I know that existence has traveled the whole finite timeline from the very beginning until it reached me.
Can you follow this? A bit?
I don't know.
You don't know. Anyone? Makaya, I see your face. Can you follow or no? Okay, think of this path, right? This road. Now, look at the road. This is the best image I could find for it. But you see, it seems to be going into eternity. So let's say this road, you follow it. You can never reach the end because it goes on and on and on and on and on. According to this line of thinking, if you imagine the ultimate cause of your existence to be at the end of an infinite timeline, the beginning of your existence would be infinitely far away. Even if you could travel back in time, the distance back to that cause would therefore be untraversable. You would never be able to reach it. But at the same time, for us to exist, that ultimate course of existence must have its effect across that infinite distance. Its influence must reach all the way to us to bring us into being. Because we're talking about the cause of existence. That's ultimate, at the beginning of a line of cause and effect. It has to reach us from the infinitely distant past all the way to the present. And because it's infinitely distant, it could never reach us. However, as I just said, as that road is infinite, existence can never get all the way to us. Therefore, if existence was not created in time, if existence was eternal with no beginning, we could never have come into existence. Now, the idea of time, this idea of time as a straight line may not hold water in the face of modern scientific thinking. We don't want to take away credit from Saadia. It was still a surprisingly creative way of reasoning, especially for someone 1,100 years ago. But recent science doesn't see time always, I think usual right now, as a straight line. Perhaps it could be an eternal loop. Sorry, the loop also goes indefinitely, but there's no end point, but still eternal, right? And this was funny because it was in the show, The Good Place, they visualized the loop of eternity as a totally different way, and it looked exactly like the words Jeremy bearing me or something, whatever. It's funny. Okay.
Just like, hold on. This is me, okay? This is you. And I'm going over this line, but this is infinite. I can never get here. Can never get here. Let's say this is the end of infinity, but it's infinitely far, so it could never get here. Now, from if something would be here, it could also never get to me. So if infinity is existence is infinitely far away, and existence travels on a timeline, because he sees time as a line, right? On a timeline, like here. Now, this is maybe when my grandparents were born, my parents are born, they met each other, and I'm born, and now I'm here. So there's a time travels basically like this. If the beginning of time is infinitely away, it could never reach me, so I could never be born. Isn't that a funny way of thinking? I don't know if she doesn't get it. But okay, I hope so. Think about it. Yeah, okay. We'll go to another topic. How he thinks the existence of God. Let's go to Imoni. This is treatise two.
Based on what we see, we naturally find it hard to imagine that God has no beginning because everything we know does. Revelation teaches us, I am the first and I am the last, and aside from me, there is no other guide. Isaiah 44:6. How does this jive with reason?
Yeah, how can we reason this, that God must be out of time, must have no beginning?
If we would assume that the creator also needed a creator, we must then conclude that this earlier creator required a creator as well. We must then say that God was created by Z, and Z was created by Y, and Y by X, in an infinite series going back in time without a beginning, in other words, without a first cause. However, if there was no first cause, then the process of existence never started, which means nothing could ever exist. Since we know we exist, there must be a first cause without a beginning. This we call the creator.
Maybe goes a bit fast. Can you follow it? Sometimes when you read yourself, it's hard to concentrate on the contents. I have that sometimes. What?
No, I'm fine, nothing.
You understand it?
Sort of. It's kind of like intertwined.
So if God cannot have a beginning, then he has to be created by another creator, okay? So somebody's in front of that. So, but if this, then this, but why would God not be able to be eternal? Then this person also could not, or person or thing, could not be eternal either. So it needs a creator also. And this one too, and this one too. And there is no end, and there's never a first cause, and never a first creator, because they all need something else to be created. That means there cannot be a first creator, and therefore we cannot exist. That's his idea so he said there has to be a first cause, a first cause that put everything in motion, and that we call the creator, that we call God. And that's also not necessarily a personal God, or a God that you can relate to in a personal way. That's a different story. But this is what he says. There is a first cause of all causes. And so that has to be an eternal one that does not start in time, but before, outside of time. It's very interesting, because I personally, and maybe I'm not a scientist, for ages, religious people have said that they believe, based on their religion, on revelation, that the world is created out of nothing. And scientists have said, no, nothing can come out of nothing. That's not possible. So matter has to be eternal. And now with the Big Bang, it seems that the universe came out of nothing. Of course, what created the universe? If the Big Bang itself created time and space, then the cause of the Big Bang must have been out of space, outside of space, which is basically what he's saying. I find it, look, I'm not saying that this cannot be rebunked ever, and scientists are very smart, and they come up with other things and other explanations. I don't think yet, but I'm sure they're looking frantically for an explanation. So far, it's pretty cool and brilliant that through that Saadia Gaon's thinking basically taps in a lot to what we now see. There's plenty of atheist scientists. Although I believe personally, that's my inkling, that atheism is partially caused because as a reaction against an oversimplification of the idea of God. If you just say God, by saying that all the things we say about God are literally true and he's really a father and he cries over, and those are, I think, metaphors he gets angry and stuff. Those are, I think, metaphors of deeper spiritual principles that we just need to relate to, and therefore, but if you take this in a literal way for a scientist, that doesn't make sense. There is no person sitting on a throne above the clouds, about the stars. We look into the stars and we don't see any floating throne there. So that is not a image they can work with. But if you, for a more abstract and intelligent idea about God, and you don't even have to call it God, if you dislike the word God, God is also just a word, right? But there is something, there's this power in the universe that enables existence, and existence is the biggest miracle of all. There's no reason, according to me, to how I see it, there's no reason normally for anything to exist. Why is there anything existing? That is, for me, the biggest miracle and mystery. Okay, but I'm going on, and now it becomes a class on creation. It has to be about Saadia Gaon. But once again, he is very much in line with these thoughts. I find that cool. So let's go to another topic. What is it? God is one is another important idea of the Kalam people. It's also an idea of Islam, very strongly. It's also an idea of Judaism. It's to some extent an idea of Christianity, less so because of the Trinity, right? There's still three persons. What does it mean? And how does he reason that God is one? What does that mean? Okay. I don't know, Imoni, you just read only one, so do another one.
Another prominent position of the Kalamis was that God is one. This too seems obvious for a monotheistic religion. However, their conclusions were more radical than some of the other monotheists.
So what do you think is monotheism? How would you, when I tell you, Imoni, we're going to talk about monotheism. What do you think when you hear the term monotheism?
The belief in one God.
Yeah. So God is one is often just seen as, oh, that just means there's one God. But they go further than that. Mm-hmm.
If God is truly one, that must mean he has no body. A body is not only limited, but also has limbs and body parts.
No,
a body
sorry for the interruption, because I don't know, that's how I teach. I can't help it. And if I wait with interruption, then I forget what I wanted to say. So it's not just that there's one God. They believe that this one God is also in himself one and cannot be divided, cannot be seen as a composite of certain parts. And we just saw in his second argument of the creation of the world, that anything that is a composite of parts is created. So if God is uncreated, and there must not be a composition of different things. Let's say we have, if God would have a body, would have a head and shoulders and hands and feet and all these things, which are body parts, and he has no parts. So because he's one, he cannot even dissect God in above and below. That's, that would already be hard. It's like a big Pluto. I'll visualize it as an amoeba or something. Uh-huh.
So it just proves that God has no image, because if God had an image, then you'd be able to see intricate parts, but there's no intricate parts.
Yeah, there are no parts because he's just one, and one. You know, nothing. So even saying, and this goes much further, even saying, he doesn't go this far, but a bit, yeah, he does. Even saying God became angry, then he has anger and he has forgiveness and he has love, which are different emotional things. He can only be one thing at the same time. And so that becomes a little tough for people to relate to him, because you know, God is displeased supposedly when you do something wrong, and he's pleased when you do the right thing. But those are human emotions. And so that would be not just that it's an anthropomorphism, describing God in a few sentences, but there's also different aspects of God.
But that they explain that as like God has different human characteristics, just as a way to relate to people reading it.
You've been, yeah, exactly. You've been studying Maimonides probably a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now we're going to get to that again with Maimonides, but it starts here. Exactly. Yeah. So it's only so we can relate to it, but the relation, the relating and the image that we have is not accurate, because the essence of God, once again, is so different from what we know, is so above our comprehension that we cannot grasp the essence of God. And so we're only dealing with imagery. But so if you peel that away, only the essence of God is a mystery, is a force, is something, is basically that I think a scientist could live with. It's like something you cannot define in the first place. There must be something there, but I cannot put my finger on it. And that's how abstract it becomes, right? Yeah. Some people have a hard time because they want to just see God as compassionate and putting his arm around your shoulder and just giving you a handkerchief when you cry, you know? I understand that too. And it's fine probably, because those are images that are kosher, that are okay. Okay, Imoni, take it away.
A body has certain bodily functions and organs, which goes against an absolute oneness. Being truly one also means that God has no human characteristics whatsoever, such as emotions. If he had anger and compassion, then he would move between two different emotions, which would take away from God's unity and consistency.
Yeah, consistency, there would be change in God, unless he has both of them eternally, because he's outside of time. But you could still say that it has parts. Unless these two are just different names for one thing. I mean, there's all long discussions about this. Long discussions. Okay. Yeah?
Plato taught in his philosophy of ideas that everything in this world has several variable features, size, color, shape, etc., called accidents.
Yeah, this is a bit of a repeat, but okay.
Strip all this away and you are left with the idea of the object, its essence, which is invisible and unimaginable, yet this essential idea is the real thing. Calumnists believe that God, the creator, is essentially different from anything created. Most importantly, he has no accidents, but is a pure essence.
Yeah, very good. Now let me see who else. Alex, I see you. Are you ready and able, willing and able?
Therefore, as God is incorporeal, all God's attributes, described characteristics of God, are mere allusions to something transcendent. All descriptions of God in human-like shapes or forms, anthropomorphisms, must not be taken literally. Instead, they are metaphors of a deeper spiritual concept. For instance, when scripture describes God as sitting on the throne, or that the earth is the footstool to his feet, that symbolically refers to his majesty. When we read about his strong outstretched hands, it is a metaphor for his power.
Beautiful. So we spoke about last Monday that Saadia wrote Arabic Bible translation, and it's called the Tafsir. Tafsir is Arabic, and it means actually explanation or commentary. So it's he wants to say, and maybe read the small letters.
Tasfir means explanation. This indicates that Sahadid does not give a literal translation, but rather explains the deeper meaning behind the literal, sometimes anthropomorphic text.
Yeah, so he does that a lot. So when there's a God, smells the delicious flavor aroma of the sacrifice, then he would say he approves the sacrifice or things like that. So we're going to give I'm going to show you a few examples. The first is Genesis 1 verse 3.
And God said, let there be light, and there was light.
So speaking, saying something, is what you do with your mouth and your vocal cords and your lips and your tongue. And that's, so he said, saying is that it has to be a metaphor for something different from deciding, maybe. This is the Hebrew on top. Saadia's tafsir says, it is in Arabic.
And God, Allah, willed there to be light, and then there was light.
Yeah, so it was his will that did it, not really a physical speech. In Arabic, washa Allah, maybe people know the word inshallah, if God wills. That's exactly the verb that he uses. What does it say on the bottom of the slide?
Saadid finds the notion of God who speaks too anthropomorphic to be translated literally.
Yeah, very good. Go to the next one. Genesis 1 verse 4.
God saw that the light was good, and God made a separation between light and darkness.
Everybody already now recognizes seeing is a physical thing, but it's a spiritual kind of seeing. So the tafsir says,
as God knew that light was good, blah, blah, blah.
Right. Okay, exactly. And knowing is something that can be eternal. I think this is the last one of three. Genesis 6, verse 6.
The Lord saw that the evil of man was great on earth, and the Lord regretted that he had made man on earth, and he grieved, and it grieved in his heart.
Yeah, so obviously regretting is a very human thing. I mean, he did something, and then he thought, I shouldn't have done that, and why did I do that? That's regretting, and grieving in his heart means, meaning in God's heart, that he has regrets, right? But now, this is an interesting example because the tafsir turns it in a very creative way around. And so what does it mean, say now? Marlene, please.
Okay. The Lord saw that the evil of man was great on the earth, and the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and he grieved in his heart.
God, well, what Allah, does the tafsir make of it?
Mm-hmm. God Allah made them feel sorry by what he did to the earth, and he placed grief in their heart.
So he translates vayinahem not as a passive form, but as a transcendent verb. That means not the regret didn't come to overcome him, but he caused the regret. So he caused the regret into the heart, not of his heart, God's heart, but in man's heart. And so it's all based on interpreting the Hebrew. It's a very creative way to say, God cannot feel sorry, but he made, it just means that he made the humans feel sorry, what they did on earth. How did he do that? He made the humans feel sorry. They feel bad, and they were grieved in their hearts. How did he do that? By what God was actually doing. God did things to the earth that made the humans now feel bad. Okay, not about what they did, but what God did. Okay, all these evil people. Yeah. However,
there are some texts in the Hebrew Bible that cannot easily be explained as anthropomorphic metaphors. One is in the description of Moses' close encounter with God. Moses asks, show me, please, your glory. God answers, you cannot see my face, for man cannot see me and live. And later, you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen.
So how do you see that? A metaphorical back? What is that? There are people who say that means You cannot see the God's influence when it faces you, but after the fact, you can see that God was at work. That could be an interesting, but then it says God's Moses saw God's back, and et cetera, et cetera. How do you explain that in a metaphorical way? So that's a hard one. Another text.
I saw the Lord sitting on his throne and all the host of heaven standing by him on his right side and on his left.
Yeah, this is a, I'm sure this is, so what does he, what, how does Saadia explain this in Treatise 2?
Saadia writes on this. This form that was seen was something created. It was a form nobler even that of angels, magnificent in character, resplendent with light, and it is called the glory of God. It is this form too that the sages characterized as Shekinah. Okay. Yeah. Saadia also writes that another name for this created form is the angel of the Lord.
So this is, we're going to see this in a future class. He introduces an idea, and once again, I'm not 100% sure if he's the first one, but first one I think that we know of, that God actually, yes, Moses saw an image, and Ezekiel saw an image when he saw God on a throne, but it was not God itself. It was God created an image specifically for that purpose, to represent God. So he's actually giving an image to the people, so they needed to see something. All right, I'll give you a... how do you say that, a hologram or something, and it's not me, but it's just something that you can think of as me. And so the angel of the Lord appears a lot in the Torah. So it says Moses got up and he had a dream, or it means it doesn't say he had a dream, but at night, and he had this commandment, go and sacrifice your son. I mean, some people say that's not really what it said. Bring your son up for a sacrifice. Does it mean he has to be sacrificed? All interpretation. But then later, when he's about to sacrifice his son, it says the angel of the Lord spoke to Abraham. So the angel of the Lord comes up a lot. And so this is basically this, according to Saadia, this hologram that God created. Of course, hologram doesn't say, but the glory of God, the Shekhinah, the angel of the Lord. Uh-huh.
Treatise 2, God, chapter 12. God has a special light which he creates and shows to his prophets. When one of them sees this light, he says, I have seen the glory of the Lord. Often, however, he would simply say, I have seen God by way of ellipsis. In Exodus 24:10, and they saw the God of Israel, in Exodus 24:17, and the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like devouring fire on the top of the mountain.
That's in the same pericope. That's in the same paragraph. They saw God, and a few lines later it says they saw the glory of the Lord. So meaning that the glory of God, whenever, that's the same thing. So they didn't see God, but they saw the glory of God. And the two are sometimes used in exchange for each other. But every time people claim to have seen God, it was really this glory, this kavod. Kavod is on top, you see. That's the Hebrew word for kavod or kabod, however you want to explain it. And this is going to come up in the... Now we're going to look at, once again, time goes so fast. It's unbelievable how fast the class goes. The Messianic redemption, how does it see that, Marlene?
Saadia writes that the Messiah will come when the Jewish people fully repent from their sins. However, if they don't fully repent, there is an end, a deadline when God will send the Messiah anyhow. However, in such a case, God will bring about hardships and calamities that will force the people to repent so they will deserve the redemption.
Yeah, I'm just only putting this in because you'll see it's kind of something you know and can relate to. Uh-huh. He writes in Treatise 8.
There will be the appearance in Upper Galilee of a man from among the descendants of Joseph, and he will gather individuals from the Jewish nation. This man take Jerusalem after it was seized by the Romans, and he will stay in it for a certain length of time.
Yeah.
Then they will be surprised by a man named Armelus, who will wage war against them and conquer the city and subject its inhabitants to massacre, captivity, and disgrace. Among those are slain will be that descendant of Joseph.
I'm not going to, it's a long story what will happen, but what is it, where does he have this from? Armelus, do you remember Armelus?
It sounds familiar, but I'm not sure.
Okay, who? Who knows? Amy?
Wasn't it with Anan that we spoke about this?
You're looking in former classes, which is good, but not that class. It was, remember, it was in the story, Byzantine Jews before the advent of Islam, when Menachem ben Hushiel, that it was called the Chronicles of Zerubbabel. And so Armillus was the enemy that had to be conquered. Probably look back at it. But this has to be this whole thing. Also, if you look back at here in the Upper Galilee, that's where the revolts, when the Jews fought with the Persians and they conquered Jerusalem. And then there was a revolt and the Jews were killed later. So it looks to me that this Chronicle of Zerubbabel was circulating, that Saadia had a copy of it, read it, used it, believed it, but didn't know about the historical event that it related to. So this whole thing had happened already, right? But he's telling that something's going to happen in the future. Okay. I thought I'll put that in. Good and bad deeds. Kevin.
Saadia sees reward and punishment as something akin to a heavenly accountancy. When we do good deeds, we get merits, good points, so to say, or credit. And when we do bad deeds, we get demerits, bad points. Some good deeds are more meritorious than others, and some sins are more serious than others.
I have to see. We have 1 minute. Maybe you can read this yourself. But that's basically what he believes is, it's basically just an accountancy of heaven. And if you have a little bit more good deeds, then you go to the good place, and if not, to the bad place. And some things, but you can repent, but some things you cannot repent for. Perjury, shedding innocent blood, adultery with a married woman, testifying falsely against a defendant. That is resurrection. This is really interesting. 11 o'clock. Do we have 5 more minutes, guys? 5 more minutes, yeah? Okay, good. Thank you, Samantha. I'll take your word that everybody agrees with you. Okay. Which is interesting. There's a notion of a resurrection of the dead. Now, if you believe that your soul is so important, and if you believe that you die and that your soul goes to, you get the reward, you go to heaven, you're in the spiritual world, wouldn't that be wonderful? And why would you have to go back into your body if that is on a lower level? So he has, and people have struggled with that because there's different images of the hereafter that seem to contradict with each other. So the resurrection of the dead seems to somewhat contradict the idea of the ideal of a spiritual bliss in somewhere in spiritual whatever state. Now, he says, he says, okay, God will bring, so when people die, the soul is separated from the body. That seems to be obvious, but he's going to bring them back together. That's the resurrection of the dead. Basically, the body is going to be reconstructed and revived and new and healthy, and the soul is going to be, but why? Why? Okay, so he says, because the soul and the body are together when they sin. And so they get together. Not the soul only doesn't sin without the body, and the body doesn't only sin without the soul. They only sin in cooperation with each other as a unit, and therefore they have to be punished as a unit. Here, Rachel, would you like to read this?
Yeah. Rabbi Ishmael compared this to a king who had an orchard in which there were excellent fruits. The king placed guards to watch over the orchard. One of them was lame and the other blind, and he instructed them to guard the fruits. A while later, the lame man said to the blind man, I see fine first fruits in the orchard. The blind man said to him, let's eat them. Do you not realize that I cannot walk, said the lame man? Do you not realize that I cannot see, said the blind man? So the lame man rode on the blind man's back, and together they went and ate the fruits, and they each returned to their place. A while later, the king entered the orchard and asked, where are these fine fruits? The blind man answered him, my lord the king, do you not realize I cannot see? And the lame man answered him, my lord the king, do you not realize that I cannot walk? The king, being a wise man, what he did What did he do? He placed the lame man on the back of the blind man and said to them, thus you did and you ate the first fruits. Similarly, the Holy One, blessed be he, says to the soul, why did you sin against me? The soul answers, Lord of the universe, I did not sin. It must have been the body that sinned. For since the moment I departed from it, I am just like a pure bird flying away in the breeze. How could I have sinned against you? Then he says to the body, why have you sinned against me? The body answers, Lord of the universe, I did not sin. It must have been the soul that sinned. For without it, I am like a stone cast upon the earth. As such, how could I have sinned against you?
Yeah, right. So now God brings the body back into the soul, back into the body. And that's how he judges them. Hereafter, he takes there's a saying, the world to come. Maimonides, who we're going to talk about later, says, no, that's a spiritual world. The world to come is not a new world. But Saadia takes it literally. He says, there's a new world that's bigger and more spacious. And it's going to be created for that after the resurrection. But the body is not going to need anything. It doesn't have diseases. Also doesn't need to eat or drink. And so in his idea, we don't need water. We don't need food. Fields of wheat. No trees are necessary. No roads, because you can just fly through the air. And there's nothing. So it seems to be not really a paradise. It's very, no animals, no pets, nothing. And then he believes that there is a fire, but fire can be warming and also can be hurting. It's the same fire, but for the good people, it's going to be warming and wonderful, and it's only going to give light. But for the bad people, it's going to only give pain and hurt. So I have a question here. Does that jive with God being just? Most Jews do not think that anything like a punishment in the hereafter is forever. It's only to learn your lesson, I guess, to realize what you did. But the question is, if people sin in this life, our life is temporary. Our sins are temporary, therefore. We only sin, if we sin, we do it temporary, not eternal. No sin is eternal. So if any punishments are just, why would you get a eternal punishment for a temporary sin? That's a question I asked. And then abrogation, there's a few other, we spoke about abrogation in the class on Jews under Islam, and I gave a few examples, and I have a few more, but that you can read for yourself, because we know the principle of abrogation. Thank you so much. It's exactly 5 extra minutes, Samantha. I stuck to my time. And thank you so much for your extra 5 minutes. I hope you enjoyed this class. I hope you'll go through some of the screens that we didn't finish, go through it yourself. I think it's interesting. I think they're self-explanatory. And I thank you again. Monday, there is no class because of Day of Atonement. So try to make up for all the bad things you did. And if you did something nasty to your parents or your boyfriend, just make it up again. It's always a time to start a new fresh slate, Jewish or not. It's always a good thing. So, and then we see each other all as blank slates on Thursday again. And then we'll talk about other exciting stuff.